One. Is that in front?
Yeah.
Cool. What is your full legal name, sir?
Ian Thomas Garner MacKaye.
MacKaye. Everyone wanted to know how to pronounce it, so now we know. MacKaye.
You didn't know how to pronounce my name?
I've heard people going, what? MacKaye?
But you've known me for how many years?
MacKaye. Well, you've never said your full name to me.
Maybe.
I've heard people say it.
That's weird.
Yeah. Do you consent to be filmed for this documentary?
Yes.
You had to be anointed by God to play music. And God, in this case, being sort of the major label system, whatever, or just like American culture, which seemed to be completely control all music. In my mind, like top 40 culture. So I kind of gave up on that idea completely, and I just ended up skateboarding through the 70s, which was great because skateboarding really taught me to sort of how to redefine the surroundings, you know? It made me think like, well, I don't have to look at it as a sidewalk. It's like whatever I want it to be because skateboarders just look at things differently. I think it's not limited to skateboarders either. I think that everybody does that, whatever real passion they have, they look at the world through that kind of those eyes. So I think that when I got reintroduced to punk rock, like when this came to my life, and it really was like, you know, one of those things when I was in high school arguing with friends about like who was tougher, Nugent or Ramones, you know. And you know, I was solidly in the Nugent corner. But then they said, well, you take these records home. Take these fucking records home and then compare. And when I did that, I realized, wow, this is what I've been looking for. This actually is something that is like, is tangible. Like, I understand this music. It scares the shit out of me. It's got all kind of, it's not just a commercial product. I mean, that's what I felt like. It was not just something that was like, this is what you're going to buy this week prior to what you're going to buy next week. I knew it was like a whole different world. And what's ironic about a lot of the major label CDs is that they're priced, it's insane how much they're priced, because in fact, they're paying like 40 cents each for those things. And just plastic. It's like, if that, you know, the amount of money that's generated on those things is just outrageous.
Well, you're paying for rental cars and you're paying for hotel rooms and
you're paying for it all.
Accounts and cocaine and
you're paying for
fancy
right.
dinners. Yeah.
So I think that from our point of view, on the one hand, it's based on the other thing is it wasn't just that the labels kind of woke up. It's that a lot of kids, a lot of people who were kids in the early 80s and the mid 80s, like who got involved with music through punk, then kind of got into the business of rock and roll, and then they got in the position of A&R positions at record labels, you know, and they were going out and like speaking with, you know, they're going to their friends and saying, hey, you should be on this label because now I have a job there. It's like, you know, typical like nepotism, like, you know, like you get a, you know, someone gets a job at an ice cream store and then everyone else in the goddamn town, you know, every other person gets a job there too. It's a very normal thing to happen. And how many bands go all the way through with it? Not many. And they're always boring. Their stories are always boring because it always ends up, and then, you know, and then they just cashed in. I mean, how could an artist not be real from the word go if they decide to make art? That's like, they're real. It's like, there's like this sense that they're not actually authentic artists until they make money.
That is,
in fact, I didn't particularly want to have a record label because it generally sucks on a lot of levels. It's a horrible business. Doesn't mean everybody involved with it is horrible. It just means that when you try to roll art and commerce together, it gets ugly sometimes. If we go in there and say, well, look, we want to do a $5 or $6 door, you actually will see a reversal. Well, people are like, well, geez, if you're not going to ask for that much money. And also, we don't even work on guarantees. We work on straight percentages. So it's sort of a no-brainer for most promoters. And once they realize that they're not being faced with this, like, guarantee command, then people are usually willing to back it out. Like, say, like, well, if you're being reasonable, then so will we. It's not impossible, but most bands will not even consider it because their management, it doesn't behoove their management to make less money. The management wants to make more money. Someone said, they're like, do you believe in God? I said, well, I'm a faithful agnostic, so I just don't have a fucking clue. But I feel like that you can live like a good life if you think about it. It's just a matter of being considerate of what's going on.
Stepping on people.
Yeah. And if that's not spiritual, then I don't know what it is.